Small turboprop engines have arrived and many are claiming it is the future of light aircraft propulsion. But can it challenge piston engines on fuel economy and cost? Let's find out. Like anything, turboprops have pros and cons. But in general, turboprops are desirable because they're extremely reliable, much more so than piston engines. This comes down to having far fewer moving parts and, unlike piston engines, no reciprocating components. Everything just rotates, which reduces mechanical stress and makes turboprops perfectly smooth running with zero vibration. This also makes turboprops extremely light compared to piston engines, giving them excellent power-to-weight ratios. And despite being lightweight, they're extremely durable, with significantly higher TBO hours than piston engines. For example, the popular Pratt & Whitney PT6A turboprops have TBOs between 3,000 and 6,000 hours, depending on the variant. Turboprops also gain efficiency as altitude increases, usually peaking upwards of 20,000 feet. But service ceilings of turboprop aircraft often exceed 30,000 feet. The King Air 250, for example, has a service ceiling of 35,000 feet. And at those altitudes, it's the propeller that becomes the limiting factor, not the turbine. We'll explore turboprop disadvantages throughout this video, but traditionally, the big disadvantage has always been one thing: fuel efficiency. Most will have some idea what a turboprop is and how it works, but let's do a quick recap. A turboprop is a gas turbine, like a turbojet, but instead of creating thrust directly, it spins a propeller. But that leaves out important details. A turbojet draws in air and compresses it through multiple stages, raising pressure and temperature. Fuel is injected into the compressed air and ignited in the combustion chamber. The resulting high-pressure, high-temperature gases expand through the turbine, which drives the compressor, and the expanding gases exit at high velocity through the exhaust nozzle. In a turboprop, the process is more or less identical, until where the hot, high-pressure gases expand through the turbine. Here, the turbine not only spins the compressor, but also drives the propeller through a reduction gearbox. This is the key difference. In a turboprop, most of the exhaust energy is used to drive the propeller. Very little energy remains in the gases when they exit, contributing minimal thrust. The propeller provides nearly all forward thrust by accelerating a large volume of air rearward. Now, to understand why turboprop combustion is less efficient than piston engine combustion, we need to look closer. The first factor is basic thermal efficiency. Modern piston engines can achieve thermal efficiencies of 35%, while small turboprops typically achieve 25%. This is because piston engines can operate at much higher peak pressures and temperatures during the power stroke. The confined combustion in the cylinder is simply more efficient at extracting energy from fuel than the continuous combustion process in a small turbine. The second factor is turbine inlet temperature limits. To avoid damaging turbine blades, combustion temperatures have strict upper limits, and this reduces efficiency because higher temperatures would extract more energy from the fuel, but the materials can't handle the heat, so efficiency suffers. Piston engines have temperature limits too, to prevent detonation, for example, but these aren't nearly as restrictive as turboprop limits. The third factor is efficiency at partial power settings. Piston engines maintain or sometimes even improve efficiency at lower power settings, but turboprops are usually most efficient at full power and become less efficient as power is reduced. This happens because turboprops use fixed geometry, since the compressor and turbine blades are angled and sized to work best with a specific amount of air rushing through them. At reduced power with less airflow, these blades simply can't compress air as effectively. This results in lower pressure ratios and less efficient combustion. Meanwhile, the engine still has the same internal friction and still needs to drive the same oil pumps and generators, whether it's making full power or half power. So these fixed parasitic loads eat up a bigger slice of your now smaller power output. This creates a problem. Most turboprops can only operate at full power for a few minutes after takeoff. And like any aero engine, they are usually run at reduced power once in cruise. And turboprop specific fuel consumption is worse at cruise power than at full power. This isn't a factor with piston engines. I mentioned earlier that turboprops become more efficient with altitude, peaking at altitudes where aircraft require pressurization. But that also means they are suboptimally efficient at lower altitudes where most privately owned, unpressurized light aircraft fly. Turboprops have another crucial disadvantage, perhaps the most important, which is scaling them down for smaller aircraft. Piston engines scale well both up and down with minimal efficiency changes. But turboprops lose efficiency when scaled down for several reasons. First is clearance between turbine tips and the casing. When making smaller turboprops, this clearance stays roughly the same, changing the ratio between clearance gap and blade length. This reduces efficiency because more compressed air leaks through the relatively larger gap. Second is aerodynamics. Smaller compressors and turbines operate at lower Reynolds numbers, which describe fluid behavior around an airfoil. The Reynolds number equation includes chord length as one factor, so without changing the other variables, smaller airfoils inherently have lower Reynolds numbers. Lower Reynolds numbers reduce efficiency because boundary layer effects become more significant relative to the blade size, creating more drag and earlier flow separation, lowering the overall efficiency of small turboprop engines. So, which small turboprops are coming to challenge the piston aero engine market? Let's look at specific fuel consumption numbers measured in pounds per horsepower hour. The Pratt & Whitney PT6A is probably the most well-known turboprop, but direct comparisons get tricky because the PT6A range is vast and can operate anywhere from 0.5 to 0.7 depending on the specific model and conditions. Of the new small turboprops, Turb Aero's Talon achieves 0.57 according to their website. Euron's website doesn't state it, but fuel burn is widely quoted at 10.5 gallons per hour at full power, and that calculates to 0.55. That is more or less where most modern small turboprops will operate. Now let's compare it to piston engines. Popular engines like the Continental IO520 and IO360 and Lycoming IO360 operate around 0.42, 0.43, but no more than 0.45. When run lean off peak, these usually dip just below 0.4. The Rotax 914, 915 and 916 all operate in the 0.41 to 0.43 region. So these small turboprops come close, but they clearly don't match piston engines. Now, before I get angry comments about me cherry-picking data to support my narrative, there is one new turboprop claimed to achieve 0.45 pounds per horsepower hour, the TurboTech TP-R90. But using the data provided on their website, I calculate 0.5 pounds per horsepower hour, though that's at just 50% power. Since turboprops generally achieve better specific fuel consumption at higher power settings, let's assume the claims of 0.45 is correct at 75% power. Even so, it barely matches piston engine fuel consumption at its worst. It doesn't beat it. Still, that's very impressive for a small turboprop and raises some questions. How can this engine efficiency jump from the turboprop industry benchmark of 0.55 down to 0.45? If we remember the standard turboprop illustration, after combustion, hot gases expand through the turbine and exit through the exhaust. That's a lot of wasted heat energy, especially at partial power settings. That's where recuperation comes in. Recuperation recovers this wasted exhaust heat and uses it to preheat the compressed air before it enters the combustion chamber. Since the compressed air is already hot, less fuel is needed to reach optimal turbine inlet temperature, improving fuel efficiency. Now, recuperation isn't new technology. It's been used outside aviation for over 80 years. The problem has always been implementing it on aviation turbines, since it adds considerable weight, bulk, and complexity. And historically, fuel efficiency has rarely been a top priority on turboprop engines, coming only after power-to-weight ratio and reliability. Shame on them for prioritizing human safety over saving fuel and lowering emissions.
Was that sarcasm, Alfred?
Recuperators have never been very practical for aviation. So, how did Turbotech make it work on their small turboprop? First, advancements in temperature-resistant materials like Inconel and ceramics allow withstanding extreme temperatures in turbine exhaust streams. Modern computer-aided design also made the bulky heat exchanger lighter and more compact. Second, there's growing demand for turboprop engines in light aircraft. And here, fuel efficiency is becoming increasingly important, sometimes even more than traditional priorities like ultimate reliability and power-to-weight ratio. Of all the turboprop engines mentioned, only the Turbotech uses recuperation. And if the 0.45 pounds per horsepower hour claim is true, it works. It drastically reduces fuel consumption. So is that it for piston engines? Have turboprops made the technological leap required to make piston engines redundant for light aircraft? Let's consider some facts. At 0.45 pounds per horsepower hour, it doesn't beat many F-gas piston engines, does it? At best, it matches it. I think many people saw the claimed 20 liters per hour and thought, yeah, that's far better than my piston engine. But that's at only 50% power, which is just 71 horsepower and is not a realistic cruise power setting for most aircraft. Light aircraft generally need at least 65% power in cruise, and most would operate around 75%, which would increase that 20 liters per hour to about 30 liters per hour. But that's actually not bad. Turbotech's 141 horsepower TPR90 competes directly with Rotax's 141 horsepower 915IS, which consumes around 26 to 27 liters per hour at 75% power. That's close enough if you factor in reliability, since most sensible people would accept a slight fuel penalty for massively improved reliability, but only if the purchase cost isn't much higher. The Rotax 915 cost around $50,000 at the time of recording, at most $55,000. Now, I've been told Turbotech targets $60,000 for the TPR90, but I can't find any credible sources confirming this. I did find an online interview where Turbotech stated their TGR90 will cost around 140,000 euros. That's roughly $160,000. That's the turbo generator version, which includes the generator, and the turbo prop version would likely be somewhat cheaper, and most indications seems to be around $130,000. But an AOPA article boasted it would go for substantially less, $100,000. Let's assume that's correct. $100,000 is really not as horrible as it sounds. But does it really compete with similarly powered piston aero engines to the degree of making it obsolete? I can imagine specific use cases where superior reliability justifies any cost. But for the average Joe light aircraft owner who already considers $55,000 for the Rotax 915 outrageous, I just don't see it happening yet. Even if we ignore costs for a moment, we need to consider one more thing. While recuperation massively reduces fuel consumption, it adds significant complexity, which is not to be underestimated. The heat exchanger is an intricate technology with super thin walled sections. It adds weight and bulk, and would need frequent inspection, since leaks could have consequences ranging from minor issues to engine failure in rare cases. So will it be able to retain that superb reliability we've come to expect of a turboprop? Only time will tell. With specific fuel consumption so close to piston engines, we might overlook these details because finally a small turboprop that can just about compete with F-gas piston efficiency, even if it's a bit expensive for most private operators. Turbo Aero's Talon and Yaron's GVA130 appear much cheaper. Heck, at the reported cost, I'd almost call it affordable. But then you have to deal with much lower efficiency due to no recuperation. But that is a trade-off that many would be willing to make. You can thus have superior efficiency at significant cost, or you can have an affordable turboprop but with high fuel consumption. So calling turboprops the future of light aircraft propulsion seems a bit ambitious at this stage. While they come close to F-gas piston engines in efficiency, I've neglected to mention diesel or Jet A piston engines, which can achieve down to 0.35 pounds per horsepower hour, with the Continental CD135 and 155 as examples achieving 0.36, which is significantly out of reach of small turboprops. That said, what TurboTech has achieved is admirable. They took a massive step towards making turboprops more efficient, and I hope to see their recuperation technology enable some smaller turbofans, which could make some very exciting 2- and 4-seat jets possible. What do you think? Are small turboprops the future of light aircraft despite the mentioned roadblocks? And are they as accessible to the average light aircraft owner as you might have thought at first? Let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one.